blessings that way. I forgot to mention the missions offering this month, and you're probably aware of that. North Carolina missions offering, all the income for this doesn't stay in our church or our area here. It stays involved in North Carolina mission starts, new churches, Baptist men, recovery efforts across our country as they go to help folks in disaster relief and whatnot. So give generously if you can. I think our goal is 600, I believe, this time around. But you give us a little bit so we can do it. Let me ask you a question this morning. How many of you had a chance this week to invite somebody using the invitation card we gave out a couple weeks ago, and we gave them out last week too, if you want? How many of you had a chance this week to invite at least one person? Just raise your hand if you had. Right? Good. Keep it up. There's some more out the back there. You can go out, pick a few up. Just keep them in your pocket, your wallets, purse, any form you can. To just walk around with them in your pocket as you see people. In the county here, especially in the Yankee County area. I know if you're in Winston or somewhere, it's not so easy. Of course, you can always invite folks and say, hey, if you're right away, we'd love to have you come visit. Use it as an opportunity to evangelize. Not so much to have time to witness, but using that blue card, because on the back, you just simply say, well, if you have questions about the Christian life, go to truelife.org and see what it says to you about some of the questions you may have about living for Christ. We've been sharing with us in the last few weeks, if you've noticed, a series of messages on the fact that we as believers are called to take the gospel of Christ to a lost world, to a world who needs to hear. In other words, people around us, that's the purpose for inviting folks to church or inviting them to saving knowledge of Christ. Jesus' great commission, we talked about a few weeks ago, how he told his disciples to go around the world. Assuming in the book of Acts in the early church, the growth, the magnificent, the powerful growth of this early group of people when they would come to Christ, it was the understanding that we would go out to them and bring them into a saving knowledge of Christ. Jesus' last contact with people before he went to that cross, those folks he contacted were unworthy. They were Gentiles. They were sort of half-breeds or folks who were involved with things that Jewish people wouldn't be involved with, collecting taxes for the Roman government. And yet Jesus spoke to them and said, I came to seek and to save that which was lost. Whether you're a Jew, a Gentile, or whatever, you're a lost person without Jesus, and that's what you are, he's calling you. He's telling us that's what he came for. And if he came for that, and he lives in your heart, and that's what we're to be doing, allowing him to do the same thing through us today. And we see that first, that expectation, that same expectation that we as believers are to go to the world in the first parable that Jesus gave. If you have your Bibles, turn to Matthew 13, the first few verses there. It's called the parable of the sower. The very first one he gave was this parable. As you're turning there, you might point out here, this right here is a turning point in Jesus' ministry. He had been witnessing to people, testifying, preaching, teaching, healing people all around Galilee. This is toward the end of his Galilean ministry. He's wrapping things up there. And he comes to suddenly turn to begin teaching in parables. He hadn't done this so much before because the disciples asked him, why are you doing this? Using those parables to define and explain the mystery of his kingdom. You see, in Matthew's gospel, the whole theme is him being the king. And his kingdom. The Jewish people, for Israel, Jesus came for his own received him not. And so he begins here in chapter 13 with a series of about seven parables. Now, what's a parable? A parable is a Greek word which two parts, para, we get a parallel that way, something that's alongside, and then boleo, which is the word for to cast, or to throw, or to place. So you combine the two, parables would be a story that is cast alongside something else. It is telling you something in the physical world or realm in which we understand so that you can just understand something in the spiritual, unseen world. Parables were used by Jesus to reveal truth to those who understood, who were willing to hear, who were following him. That was to reveal truth, but it was also used to conceal truth from those who were antagonistic, who did not want, who would not accept the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the literal purpose for every parable was to conceal the truth, but also to reveal truth to those willing. Matthew 11, 25, Jesus said, let me just share that. You might turn there, but listen to what Jesus said. He answered and said, I thank thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because thou hast hid these things from the wise and prudent, and hast revealed them unto babes. In other words, things that are hidden from folks who think they're wise, they think they've got spiritual understanding, or they have control of people, but they're hidden. They don't understand that. Those were babies who are simply trusting Christ and walking with Him and really don't know anything other than what their daddy tells them. That's what a babe is. They understand. It's revealed to them. Later in this same chapter, we're going to read from here, someone asked Jesus, why do you speak to these folks in parables? And this is where Jesus responded. Therefore I speak to them in parables, because they seeing, see not. And hearing, they hear not. Neither do they understand. He's giving this message, these parables, to the multitudes, including his disciples, so that if they're willing, if they're spiritually ready, and they're following Jesus and committed to Him, they can understand. But if they're antagonistic, if they're opposing Jesus, it's going right over their heads. They don't see. They don't hear. They just hear a story. You know, it's been the same way when you became a Christian. You ever noticed that years ago, perhaps? You had no interest in the Bible. In fact, people would ask you to read it, you read something, it made no sense at all. In fact, you were antagonistic to the things of Christ. In the church, you weren't interested in being at church. The farthest thing from your mind, going to a church. And then someone shared the gospel with you. You heard it either on television or a friend or maybe a pastor or someone shared with you how you could be saved. How you could turn from your sins and turn to Christ and accept Him as your Savior. And the conviction of God came upon your heart and you said, I need to know that Christ. I need Him in my life. I can't carry on the way I am. I'm lost. I'm lost in sin. And you turn from that sin, you ask Jesus to save you. He came into your heart. And all of a sudden, things completely changed. You had a different attitude. You had a different attitude towards people. You loved people you didn't care for before. But one thing that really changed was the Bible suddenly became meaningful. You could understand it. When you're reading a passage of Scripture and it says, to pray without ceasing, you realize, no, I don't pray. I've never prayed. He says, pray without ceasing. And you begin doing what God says in His Word. And it makes sense. Not just to you, but to other Christians as well. It makes sense. You understand it because it's God's message to believers. We talked about that one time recently, that much of the New Testament, you know, doesn't have a concise formula for the gospel, because the message was not to lost people, the message was for Christians. But we derived out of that the message for unsaved people through His message to us. Now read with me, if you would. Matthew chapter 13, beginning in verse 1. The same day, or that day, went Jesus out of the house and sat by the seaside, and great multitudes were gathered together unto Him. So they went into a ship and sat, and the whole multitude stood on the shore. You get the picture here. Jesus went to speak to His disciples, and all of a sudden the crowds and the throngs of people began appearing on the seashore. And so He had to get into a boat, one of these fishing boats perhaps, moved it out from the shore, turned around, and there in front of Him was an amphitheater of people on the shoreline as He's speaking from the boat to these people. And He spake many things unto them in parables. By the way, He gives seven of these. We're just going to cover one today, but saying, behold, a sower went forth to sow. And when he sowed, some of the seed fell by the wayside, and the fowls or birds came and devoured them up. Some fell among upon stony places where they had not much earth, and forthwith they sprung up because they had no deepness of earth. And when the sun was up, they were scorched, and because they had no root, they withered away. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprung up and choked them. But others fell into good ground and brought forth fruit, some 100-fold, some 60-fold, some 30-fold. He who hath ears to hear, let him hear. Now we stop right there after He gives the parable and ask God to bless the reading of this His Word. Now you notice the very first verse there says something on that day, or the same day. Well, what is the same day? It's the same day that he just finished doing all these miracles and all these spiritual activities in chapter 12. And you can see all the activities he did. This is, again, wrapping up his great Galilean ministry, a ministry of teaching, preaching, and healing in the northern parts of Syria. Coming to a close, and while that is coming to a close, what is happening is opposition is arising all around him. These Pharisees and scribes and Sadducees and others didn't want what he had to offer, didn't like what he had, didn't like him. They're seeking ways in which to trip him up or get him to say something they can use as ammunition to say, well, you shouldn't be doing this, you're violating the law, and so forth, and therefore get rid of him. But opposition was growing. In fact, if you look back at chapter 12, you notice some of these things. First, with the grain field incident. Remember that one? Walking through the grain field with his disciples there in Galilee, and they just picked up some grain that was there on the stalks. Ate because they were a little bit hungry. Maybe a snack, I don't know. But these opponents saw that and said, you can't do that. This is the Sabbath day. That's work. You can't do that. And Jesus pointed out that I'm the Lord of the Sabbath. I gave the Sabbath. This made for man, not man for the Sabbath. I'm the creator of the Sabbath, by the way. Boy, that should have made them mad. And then there was a healing of a man with a withered hand. And Jesus simply said, stretch out your hand. And he did, and it was healed. And he asked him, is it okay to do that for an animal that falls in the ditch on the Sabbath day? Well, sure. And it's okay to heal somebody on the Sabbath day. Again, he's the Lord of the Sabbath. Boy, that made them angry. Listen to what they said in verse 14. They counseled together to destroy Jesus at that point. When he's saying he's the creator of the Sabbath, he's the Lord of the Sabbath, they wanted to kill him. There's the opposition. It was just right out in front of them. It was like a terrorist organization. Standing before ISIS and saying something to this effect, and they're going to kill you, destroy you. He goes on to heal a demon-possessed man in verse 22, and as a result of that, they begin saying, that's healing by the power of Satan. Jesus, Satan is behind what you're doing. And Jesus pointed out, that's blasphemy against not me, but the Holy Spirit. But as the Spirit of God is doing this work, and the Spirit of God is doing something wonderful in your midst, and you, by your opposition to the Holy Spirit, are committing blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. We call it the unforgivable sin. And it is. For us, it's the unforgivable sin of rejecting what Jesus offered us, because the same Holy Spirit's working today to reach out to you, to speak to your heart about your sinful condition, to draw you and tug on your heart to bring you to Christ, and you turn him away, you turn your back on him, you ignore him. And that's what blasphemy of the Holy Spirit is turning away from what God offers you in Christ. And then later on, they turn around and say they were seeking for a sign. Oh, just show us a sign, Jesus. He'd been doing miracles after miracles after miracles. All these signs they've been doing, they ignored it. He said, nothing, no miracle, no sign to be given you except the sign of Jonah. Because he was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the great fish. That's the sign you will receive. That's speaking of him and what he would do by rising from the dead. So there's antagonism, there's hatred all building up around him. Not just from these in Galilee, but all across Palestine and Jerusalem. These religious leaders. There's an unwillingness to hear, despite the clear evidence that what Jesus is doing and who Jesus is God in their midst. So their rejection, their turning their back on what is obviously of God, that doesn't just force Jesus. It causes and prompts Jesus to suddenly go into a new mode, and that is convey truth through parables, through these stories, these mystery stories that seem kind of odd that you're talking about them, but they have a spiritual reason. In this divine account, we see, I just see something in this account, the parable of the sower. Three emphases in this account. First of all, there's the parable itself. Look at verse 4. There's the hard soil. He lists these in chapter 13, verse 4. When he sowed, seed fell by the wayside, or the roadside, the hard surface road that had been trampled and tracked down, and it was hard. What happened then? Some birds came along. Fowl came and began eating it, devoured the seed that was there. There was no growth. There was no fruit. There was no produce coming out of those seeds. And obviously, a person who's planting seed knows that's the point of it, to have a crop and have something grow. to produce fruit? He says there's nothing there. He says there's a second soil. It's a rocky soil, full of stones, verse 5. And not much earth, there was some. And there's sudden growth, because when that seed accidentally falls past the rock down into the soil, it's got a little bit of soil in it. It produces and grows up suddenly, but the sun comes down and scorches that. Because there's not enough soil, there's not enough nourishment in that soil. And so it withers, and again, there is no fruit. And in verse 7, there's this thorny soil. That soil is choked with all kinds of weeds and thorns, and that seed falls in that soil, and guess what happens? Well, it crops up, it grows suddenly, it springs up suddenly, but as it grows, it's being choked out by the weeds around it. And what results? Again, no fruit, no produce. Those of you who have been doing farming all your life, you realize all these simple stories that we understand today. They apply today just as much as back then, as far as agriculture. You gotta get rid of the weeds, you gotta get rid of the rocks, you gotta get rid of the thing, so the crops will grow up in fruitful fashion. So we have the best produce from it. Every one of these produced nothing. But then in verse 8, he speaks about good soil. And that good soil does something. It produces a crop. And it goes from big to smaller. It says 100-fold, 100 times. Or maybe 60 times, or 30 times, but it's much better than just one time or no time. It's much better than no fruit. It's a magnificent produce. And remember who he's speaking to. He's speaking to the whole multitude here. These folks assembled on this shoreline, listening to what he's saying. On the bank, listening to the story about sowing seeds. If you're looking for spiritual truth, you'd be saying, well, that's just a story. I don't care about that. And it's interesting, this story. Jesus never identifies the sower. All the parallel accounts of this, he never identifies who the sower is. We assume it was probably Jesus himself. Who else was going around sowing seeds of the gospel but Jesus? But we apply it to us because we, in a sense, are representatives of Christ. We're going around and sowing and sharing the word of God and telling people about Jesus, and we're, in a sense, sowing that seed. But the seed is identified. Sower is not, but the seed is. It's the Word of God. Luke points that out very clearly. The seed is the Word of God. And we see that all the time. When we sow forth the seed, produce comes back, people come to Christ. But what about the soils? What do the soils represent? Some's hard, some's rocky, some's weedy, but some's good. Soil is the readiness of the human's heart, a man or woman's heart, to receive the things of God, the Word of God. And a seed, when it's sown into the soil, the ready, prepared heart that's been cultivated and ready for the Spirit of God, and the seed lands there, it produces a crop. Notice how Jesus points out, he explains this parable, by the way. Many parables he does not. We just sort of have to guess what he's saying. And by the way, you can make some real interpretations for some of these parables. When you start finding things or details and try to make over-explain a parable, because a parable is a simple story, it wasn't something complicated. Look at verse 19. He begins to explain this parable. When anyone heareth the word of the kingdom and understandeth it not, then cometh the wicked one and catcheth away that which was sown in his heart. This is he which receives seed by the wayside. He explains that soil. He said that hard soil is one in which it lands the seed, and the evil one, Satan, comes and just snatches it away from the word. Takes that word away, so it doesn't respond to it. Hard soul. A hard heart. Someone who thinks, no, I've got it all together, I don't need to hear about this gospel stuff. I don't hear about the Jesus stuff. And the evil one. There's birds in the first part of the story, now it's the evil one. He's the one who compares there and takes it away. But then secondly, in verses 20 and 21, there's the rocky soil. He hears the word. He temporarily receives it with joy. It's so great to hear this word. Man, this is wonderful. It's so emotional. But when difficulty comes, when persecution comes, when the enemy comes and threatens to cut your head off, he says, oh, no, I'm not interested in this stuff. And he falls away. He has never turned to Christ, never totally trusted the Lord. He's rocky soil. It's simply a person who's like that. Who receives in stony place the same, hears the word, and anon with joy receives it, yet when hath not root in himself, there's nothing deep, there's nothing there to hold on to. He's offended. Then there's the thorny soil in verse 22. He explains that. This is someone who is, he receives the seed, and the thorns, who, he's the only, here's the word, the care of this world, the deceitfulness of riches. In other words, worries around him. Well, I'm too worried about how I'm going to make a living. I don't have time for this Jesus stuff. Or the deceitfulness of riches. He has all he needs. He's a king. He's royalty. He's got his family's inheritance. Everything's going fine. Don't need it. And those things choke out the Word of God, the message of the gospel. And that person is not interested. Chokes it out. All three of these first soils is described, all three of these, none of them turn to become believers, true believers. You know, some say, oh, that third one there, just a carnal believer. No, there's no fruit. There's no produce coming out of that life. That's what the seed is for, to produce something wonderful. But verse 23, there is the good soil. And that's the wonderful part of the story. He that receives the good and the good ground is he that heareth the word and understandeth, which also beareth fruit. He brings forth some 160, some 30. There are great things happening. Great results. So, the story itself is, hey, there's some seed being planted in. And the good thing is, some of it's hitting good ground, good soil. There's a second emphasis. The first is the fact that there is a parable. The second is just the reasons for the parable. What are the reasons for this parable? There's a rejection by the nation. We talked about that in the last chapter. Israel's leaders had turned away from him. The king has come. The king and his kingdom have been rejected. Every time we see these miracles in the previous chapter and other places, the folks who see them say, well, we want more signs. We want more miracles. We didn't believe the ones you did see. And they rejected what Jesus, as king, comes to offer. He came into his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power or right to become children of God. That's you and that's me when we receive Christ. In other words, this Jewish nation will be locked out. They've closed their heart to their king. They've turned away his kingdom. And so Jesus says, well, it's going elsewhere. It's going where there's good soil. Until the fullness of the Gentiles comes in. And you realize that's now? This is what's called the age of grace. Where it's not the Israelite people, the Jewish people, who are the chosen ones of God. They still have that title upon them. But they, as everyone else during this age of grace, has access to God through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. We come in faith through grace in the knowledge of Christ. Through salvation in Him. Does God do something with the Jews? Oh yes, He's got great plans for that, but not now. For right now, we're in this time of the fullness of the Gentiles coming in, and that's us. We're privileged to that. That's a great reason for this parable. There's also the compassion from the Savior. You see, he cared about these people. There were multitudes on that beach. Look at verses 1 and 2. He sat by the sea and great multitudes. There are two words there. The second word means multitudes. You can just stop there and say that. But he put a word before it that means much. Much multitudes. Great multitudes. Jesus is speaking this parable to. He's telling this to a great number of people. Because he cares about great numbers of people. He cares about you. In fact, keep your hand here in Matthew and turn back a couple chapters to chapter 9 and verse 35. And notice another time when Jesus was concerned about the great multitude. Verse 36. When he saw the multitudes, By the way, he was in a full ministry mode in this passage. He's in Galilee, preaching, teaching, and healing. When he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion. Here's that word again, multitudes. He was moved with compassion on them because they fainted and were scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd. He cared about this great, vast throng of people. He saw them individually as sheep without shepherd, wandering, lost. He saith unto the disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. In other words, there was compassion on his heart. He cared about these people. He saw them as sheep that were distressed and downtrodden, downcast. All of his preaching, all of his teaching was to the vast multitudes. He cared about people. As many people as he could ever see. There was rejection by the nation, a compassionate heart of Jesus. But thirdly, there's good news, a good song. The parable itself sounds like, man, it sure sounds like 3/4 of people are just turning their backs on this message. 3 out of 4 has closed the door and said, no, we don't want that. Hard soil, rocky soil, weedy, thorny soil. They don't want it, it seems like. But the good news is there is good soil. In other words, there is a harvest. That's the whole point he's talking about here. There's a harvest. I heard this poll or result. They found that when folks go into sales, and many of you who are salespeople know this, when you have to sell a product, either by phone, calling around, or going door to door, you sell, that those who go into that field of work, of selling, now they've been convinced that what they're selling is the right thing. They're in that because they're all for it. But when they go out and sell, 80% of those who sell leave sales because they've been rejected. 3 times, 3 rejections after 3 people closing the door, hanging up the phone, not interested. If they get 3 of those, 80% of those calling will just say, forget it, I'm not doing this, I can't do this. Leaves 20%. The 20% persevere, they have got patience, they're going to keep at it, they keep calling, they keep going, they keep reaching and trying to sell, and what they find out is that 20% is left that keeps persevering. They make 90% of the sales. They are the ones who sell. Is there any difference? Yes. It's the perseverance. It's the patience. It's the going after it. Because they know there are folks out there who will purchase it. There is a harvest. And Jesus says there's going to be a harvest. So keep at it. Keep spreading that word. Keep sowing that seed. And this parable is a harvest account. Yes, he's a sower and there's seeds and he's in some really tough soils out there that just don't seem to want it. But the truth is, the ultimate goal of this sower is to produce a harvest. He wants a return on his money for the seed or the time and the effort he has to put in to cultivate that land and get everything ready and put the seed in the ground. He wants a return. He's not just doing it for a hobby. He wants to see results out of that. But unfortunately, he's got a soil problem, isn't he? The obstacles to a generous harvest, hard soil, rocky soil, thorny soil. What do they need? They need cultivation. They need to send a tractor and a plow or something through there and break up the soil. And isn't it interesting, in Jeremiah 4:3, God writes, break up your fallow ground and sow not among thorns. He says in Hosea 10:12, sow to yourselves in righteousness, reap in mercy, break up your fallow ground, for it is time to seek the Lord. What's fallow ground? Well, you just assume it's hard ground. No, it's actually ground that has been cultivated before, but has never been seeded. No seeds have ever gone into it. It's a farmer who plows up his field and lets it sit for a year or two. Nothing's done. It's fallow. It's ready, but it's just never been seeded. He says, break that fallow ground up. How do we do that? How do we prepare the hearts, the soul, the soil of men's hearts? Because that's what this soil is. How do we change a person's heart? We can't. Can God do it? Oh, absolutely. And guess what? He'll use you. He'll use you as a believer in Christ because he takes the positive influence of believers, of Christians. Why? Because God says that we are salt and light in the lost world. That doesn't mean we shine with a flashlight in somebody's eyes and annoy them with that light. No, we just allow the light to shine itself through us. By being salt and light in the world around us. Positively influencing folks for Christ's sake. In other words, being a good citizen, being a good witness for Christ, being a positive, friendly influence on other people, not being miserable and mean to anybody, just loving people. Positive influence. But then secondly, there's a negative influence. The negative influence of God's law. The Old Testament law, the requirements of holiness. God, when you look at those Ten Commandments, you realize we can't do a single one of them. In fact, most people break them all the time. But when we point out to folks that law, those Ten Commandments, it shows God's holiness. It reveals to us how God is above us. And he asks us to do these things, but we can't do them. But we can fulfill them in Christ. And we show that law, that Old Testament principle, it reveals holiness. And what does that do? It breaks up hard hearts. It makes hard hearts realize, hey, I really am a sinner. I have committed adultery in my heart. I have stolen things before. I have actually murdered people by having an anger attitude towards them. And when that person sees himself, herself, in the light of God's law, and his holiness, it should break up a heart, hardness. If nothing else, the Holy Spirit will take that and convince that person, you're in bad shape, you'll die. Because you're going to stand before him someday. Is there a solution? Absolutely. Jesus has already paid the penalty. You racked up by the things you've done. He's already paid the penalty. It breaks hard hearts. But also, not just the soil problem this guy's had. It also has a worker problem. Jesus says in Matthew 9:37, we put a minute ago, the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray therefore the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. Wow. I mean, we can pray and ask God to send folks? Yes. Because there's some lessons. This is the third emphasis we see here, and that is the lessons of the parable. And the first lesson we learn from this parable is, it's God's harvest. Whatever we do as far as reaching out to people, it's not your or my responsibility, whether we take that and share with folks. It's God's harvest. We don't have to make people believe. We don't force people. We don't grab by the shirt collar and say, you better turn. No, we just simply let God send us. This is the testimony of one who was a sower. The Apostle Paul, listen to what he said in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. He says, I planted, which is a sowing seed, Apollos watered, but God brought the increase. It's his harvest. Paul says of himself, but I'm nothing. I don't amount to anything. That's sowing the seed. It's all about God's work. He says in verse 9, we are God's fellow workers. We're just out here sowing seed and letting God take his harvest, produce. He says, you are God's field. You are God's building. It's his harvest. Keep in mind, it's his work and his time in the evaluation of the harvest. Jesus said to his disciples in John 4:35, say ye not, there are yet 4 months, and then cometh harvest? Behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes and look at the fields, for they are white already to harvest. Disciples couldn't even see the harvest. Couldn't even see the people were ready, but Jesus could. His promise that it will produce. He says in Psalm 126, he that sows in tears will reap in joy. He that goes out sowing with great baskets of seed will come back bringing in sheaves. He says it will happen. He says in Isaiah 55, so shall my word be, it shall not return unto me void, without accomplishing that for which I sent it. It shall prosper. It's God's work, his harvest, his timing, and his promise. Why are we holding back? Let's go and sow the seed of God's word. Let's share with people their need for Christ. Love them. Cultivate God's word in their life as God does that work. Let's bow together in prayer. Heavenly Father, we rejoice in you today. In the message that you, Lord Jesus, gave to us, there is good news. It may seem like a small portion, but Lord, there's good news. There's good soil. There are receptive hearts that hear the message of Christ. You've done that work in our lives. We're so thankful that you took our interest and just a slight desire, perhaps, whatever it was that you had already worked in us and drew us to the Savior. Thank you for that. Lord, send us forth. Let us be willing to go just as you sent your apostles and others. People around us shine forth as a testimony for Christ. And then let the Word of God be a mirror upon people's lives. To see themselves as they are lost without Christ. Father, there's one here today who needs Jesus. Who's never come to a saving knowledge of Him. We pray you simply work in his or her heart. To first of all, turn away from sin. And then turn to Jesus. Say, Lord, I ask Christ to save me. Come into my heart. Make me a new person. Change me into the kind of person that's just like Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Perhaps you've been praying about a place, a church home, and God's spoken to your heart about this church. You respond by simply saying, Lord, I'll follow you. I'll do what you ask me to. In just a minute, we'll have an invitation to you as we sing it. And ask you to simply respond to that which you've done in your heart. Privately unknown, make it public. Say, yes, I'm following Christ. I want the world to know. Thank you, Lord. Again, Lord, these mysteries that we don't understand, we know that you have a purpose for them. And you bring people like us who are unworthy to a saving knowledge of Christ. And we thank you. Help us to do that which we've done in our hearts. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Our invitation is extended to you. Is number 312, softly and tenderly. If you say the word, let it be your prayer for the Lord. Let's all stand down and we sing 312.